A very good morning to you all. I take this opportunity to extend my best wishes for your learning of third semester courses. I believe you all will have a good learning experience of both theory and practical courses being offered in the current semester. You have two soft core courses, number one, biotechnology, and number two, the open elective course, which will be of your choice and will be allotted based on the marks obtained by you at your graduation level. I will be engaging the biotechnology course of credit 3:1:0 in the current semester. If you just have a close look at the course outcomes of biotechnology, the learner will be able to understand the principles of genetic engineering, will have the awareness of the current applications of biotechnology, will be able to understand the concept and applications of DNA cloning and sequencing, will be able to explain the general principles of generating transgenic plants, animals and microbes, and finally will be able to understand the concepts of industrial biotechnology and bioethics. If you just go through these course outcomes from 1 to 5, all the course outcomes are very much relevant to the present day requirement of any biotechnology industry or organization. And if you start browsing for the definition of biotechnology, we'll get several definitions, and I have picked very few of the definitions most relevant to understand the concepts of biotechnology. Biotechnology is technology that utilizes biological systems, living organisms or parts of this to develop or create different products. Another definition says it is a broad area of biology involving the use of living things or the systems and organisms to develop or make products. Yet another definition says it is the use of living organisms, their parts or byproducts in industrial applications. Now, what is common in all these definitions? That is, to develop or create different products, to develop or make products, to develop byproducts which finds application in industries. So it is all about developing a product or creating a product to be used for the problems faced by the humankind and other organisms. So biotechnology is essentially the ability to solve the upcoming problems of the world's increasing population. So we are very clear about the increase in population, which is very much rapid. As the population increases, the problems associated with the population also increases. There should be some solution to overcome these problems and look for the betterment of the humankind. But what we have to remember over here is there is a reluctancy. The reluctancy among the public to accept and support biotechnological products, especially in medicine, industry or agriculture. If you find the reluctancy among the public to accept and support the biotechnological products, then probably we may not be able to solve the problems of the world's increasing population, at the rate at which it is increasing in terms of population and encountering the problems. So we may lag behind. But the study says there is reluctancy among the public to accept and support the products derived from biotechnological innovations or biotechnological research, especially in medicine, industry or agriculture. Why this reluctancy is, or why the reluctancy to accept the biotechnological products among the public is due to the following issue. There are many safety and ethical issues raised for genetically modified crop plants, commonly abbreviated as GM, that is genetically modified crop plants. Though there are some safety and ethical issues, the reluctancy is so much that even for raising transgenic animals and plants has fueled ethical concerns. If you just look at the world in terms of GMOs, around 26 countries, they have already grown GMOs. The data is in the year 2016, and 19 developing countries have grown GMOs, and 7 industrialized countries have grown GMOs. Put together, 26 countries are in the process of marketing the GMOs, and they have already utilized the products of the GMOs. But still we find the reluctancy. If you just look at the adoption rate, the global adoption rate in terms of percentage for the top 4 biotech crops, the data is in terms of million hectares. The top 4 biotech crops are the soybeans, the cotton, the maize and the canola. In India, it is only the cotton which is accepted to be grown as a genetically modified crop plant. If we just look at the data, this represents the biotechnological approaches to grow the plant, and this percentage, this much percentage has been accepted by the public. Say for example, in soybeans, about 78% has been accepted by the public without any reluctancy. That means 78% of the soybeans grown utilizing the biotechnological approaches has been accepted. Cotton 76%, maize it is 30%, and canola it is 29%. If we just compare the cotton and the maize is having only 30%. There is lot of rejection for the crop that has been developed using biotechnological approaches. So the inference is, it is only the thought process among the public to accept and support the biotechnological products. 900 studies, that is over 900 studies and publications, have confirmed that genetically modified products, organisms are safe. Still, there is reluctancy. I would like to mention it again. And if you just look at the reproductive cloning research, wherever the reproductive cloning research is involved, scientists have faced a lot of resistance. A lot of resistance. If you just look at this article, the IAP statement calling for a ban on human reproductive cloning. Scientists have faced a lot of resistance which involves reproductive cloning research. It is all because of the acceptance or rejection by the public. So, finally, it is the public acceptance, whether it is high or low, that makes the availability en masse of the biotechnological products. But the public acceptance to these biotechnological products is rather low. Now, what is the big contribution of biotechnological tools? Why we are speaking so much about the biotechnological products or the biotechnological innovations? Why people are reluctant? Is it only the negative concepts that makes the public reluctant? Does it have any positive impact? If you just keep on looking at the positive side of the biotechnological methods or the tools, it has resulted in high yielding crop plants, more nutritive values of food grains, longer shelf life of the products, and resistance to insects and pests. What we are looking for? Crop plants with high yield, that means shorter duration, maximum yield. Yes, biotechnological tools have provided that, have proved to be producing crop plants with higher yield, more nutritive values of food grains. So if any individual wants to consume a food grain, the food grain should be of having high nutritive values, shelf life. It should not require specific conditions for storage, like minus conditions, minus degree, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, or even freezing conditions. It should not require that. The product should not require. And even the storage should be for longer durations, so that without specific conditions, can a product be stored for longer durations? Yes, biotechnological tools have given a positive answer for that. It has increased the shelf life of the product, longer shelf life of the product, because of biotechnological approaches, tools being used, and resistance to insects and pests. Insect and pest damage is very much that we are losing the most precious grains and other agricultural produces. So, resistance to the insects and pests is being offered to the crop plants. So, the problems are almost taken care of. High yielding crop plants, more nutritive values of food grains, longer shelf life, resistance to insects and pests. Now, what happens when we take up biotechnology? In biotechnology and biomanufacturing, microbes play an important role. They are very, very vital. They are the chemical factories that produce products. Now, we are speaking about biotechnological products. Here is a mention of few of the biotechnological products. Products such as amino acids, medicines or the pharma products, enzymes, and food additives. I have mentioned very few. So, microbes play a vital role in the production of amino acids, medicines, enzymes, and food additives. When we say microbes, they are the chemical factories. That means usage of microbes poses big problem. It's a challenge, a very big challenge that is encountered when we start using microorganisms. Working with deadly disease-causing microorganisms, especially for their characterization, diagnostics or therapeutics, and for the purpose of developing a vaccine, they pose a lot of potential biosafety problems. Any individual or group of people working with the deadly disease-causing microorganisms, they are prone to potential biosafety problems. Why do we use microorganisms, such microorganisms? To characterize, to obtain a new strain that could be potentially harnessed to produce a biotechnological product. The microorganisms usage could be in diagnostics, in therapeutics, or maybe in the process of developing a vaccine. Whatever may be the strata of applications, there is an increasing potential biosafety problems associated with the use of microorganisms, which is a very, very big challenge for the people working with such deadly disease-causing organisms. Thus, the biosafety and bioethics, now this becomes very, very important. Why we are keen on understanding the concepts of biosafety and bioethics. So it is being continuously expanded to combine the rational of scientific knowledge, which is growing simultaneously in the area of biotechnology. So as and when the literature related to biotechnology starts accumulating, the biosafety and bioethics is also being expanded. It is growing hand in hand with the amount of data that is being generated to understand the knowledge, or to share the knowledge, or to expand the knowledge in the field of biotechnology. There are several technical aspects of medical sciences like diagnostics and therapeutics where biotechnology is very, very vital, especially with drug resistant organisms. Due to mutations in microbial pathogen genes, they have developed unique multiple drug resistance. So even if you treat with a specific antibiotic, because of its drug resistance feature that is adapted or developed due to mutations in the genes, microbial genes, that poses enormous biohazards and raises serious biosafety issues. The issues such as scientific practices, methods, and the use of appropriate equipment. So biosafety or biohazards are very, very serious issues. So multiple drug resistance is another important factor which poses enormous biohazards and raises serious biosafety issues. So the biosafety aspects or issues have become very much important in various conditions, and they require many precautions in healthcare systems, especially in the hospitals, diagnostic laboratories, animal care systems, biological laboratories, and so on. any individual or group of people working with microorganisms are not only the people or an individual exposed to the biosafety issues or biohazardous environment, but if these microorganisms are not properly disposed, anyone who comes in contact with these microorganisms, that is disease causing deadly microorganisms, that is maybe at the hospitals or diagnostic laboratories or biological laboratories, will have serious issues. That's the reason why biosafety and bioethics play a major role, and there are set rules to be followed when using such deadly disease causing microorganisms. Similar to biosafety, we have something called as biorisk. The definition goes like this. Biorisk is the likelihood of the occurrence of serious infection due to exposure to pathogenic microorganisms or biohazards. So not only microorganisms, any other biohazardous material. It is the occurrence of serious infection as soon as there is an exposure to the microorganisms, specifically pathogenic microorganisms or biohazardous material. How to manage these biorisk? The biorisk can be managed by number one, risk assessment, number two, effective biosafety measures. That means you have to take effective biosafety measures, and biocontainment. We'll be elaborating on these concepts in detail. So the biorisk can be managed by risk assessment, effective biosafety measures, and biocontainment approaches. The first report on laboratory associated infections was published in the very beginning of the 20th century. I have given few names of the organisms. These are the major pathogenic organisms responsible for the infections. The Brucella species, the Blastomyces, the Hepatitis B virus, Salmonella typhi, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, then Venezuelan equine encephalitis virus, and so on. Since the beginning of the 20th century, there is a lot of concern for the biosafety and bioethics. As I said earlier, how to go about with assessment of risk? The processes used for risk assessment are, number one, identification of the hazardous properties of a familiar infectious agent or material. Under the assessment of risk, the first and foremost factor is to identify the hazardous property of the infectious agent or the material. So first you should be able to identify the hazardous property of the infectious agent or the material. The second thing is the activities responsible for pathogen exposure to the person. The third one is the chances of the exposure becoming a laboratory associated infection. And the fourth one is the ultimate consequences of the infection. If you can manage these, then probably assessment of the risk is possible. The biohazards may be the microbial infection causing agents or other biological materials which pose a high risk for human health, such as parasites, viruses, prions, or biologically derived toxins, allergens, we have venoms, or even recombinant DNAs. All these can adversely affect human or animal health and environment. So, adverse effect on human or animal health and environment is possible because of these biohazardous infectious agents or materials. The properties of an agent which makes it potentially hazardous are infection capability, ability to cause diseases in human or animal host, its minimum infective dose, severity of the disease, availability of vaccine, availability of therapeutic modality to nullify or control it, the probable route followed by it for transmission, stability in the environment, and the host, whether it is animal to human or only human. Probably you people will be interesting to know more about it, because we are going through the pandemic time, which is almost relevant to these points of discussion. Any infectious agent to be called it as a potentially hazardous should have the following property: infection capability, whether it is having the capability to pose high infection rate. Low infection rate, of course, will not, that is very mild, so we are not so much concerned about it. If the infection rate is very high, then there is a serious issue. Ability to cause diseases in humans or animal host. If it is only animals, then humans are safe. If it is having the ability to cause both in humans and animals, then the problem is very, very serious. Humans, whenever they come in close contact with the animals, the entire population will be under risk. So whether the infectious agent or the biohazardous agent is having the ability to cause diseases in humans or animal host, its minimum infective dose, do the infectious agent have the ability to pose serious issues with minimum infective dose? Very, very small concentration of the agent should be sufficient enough to cause high infection. So that it means minimum infective dose. Whether the vaccine is available or not, much relevant to the present day. Availability of vaccine to that infectious agent. If it is available, then the infection can be subsided. If it is not available, the infection aggravates. Availability of therapeutic modality. What are the other therapeutic approaches to control it? The probable route followed by it for transmission, similar to COVID. What are the probable route followed by it for transmission? So COVID, we are saying use mask, sanitize your hands, don't touch ear, nose and mouth to avoid the transmission. Route followed by it for transmission. Stability in the environment, whether high temperature, low temperature, ice, salt, and the host, whether it is from animal to animal or animal to human or only between humans. All these properties of that agent or an infectious agent or biohazardous material, could be toxin, animal toxin or venoms, they pose risk as potentially hazardous. Right? As I said earlier, the probable routes of pathogen transmission may be through exposed part of the body such as skin, eye or the mucous membrane, through inhalation, through needle or other sharp objects, through accidental ingestion, or sometimes through bites of mosquitoes. So all these factors decides whether the infectious agent is really posing a big problem. If it is posing a big problem, then there should be a set standard to handle it in the laboratory conditions. That is why the biosafety and bioethics play an important role. With this background, I'll end up today's session. We can continue in the next session with more details about the biosafety and bioethics. Thank you. Thank you very much.